Hello and welcome to Finding Genius. My name is Kyle O'Brien. I'm the founder of Startup ROI. And today I have the pleasure of speaking with Pierre Touzeau, who is the co-founder of Clap, which is an asynchronous meeting tool for distributed teams. Pierre, welcome to Finding Genius. Thanks for coming today.
Hi, Kyle. How are you?
I'm doing really well. So I wanted to dive right into it, talk a bit about your background. I know you spent the early parts of your career at L'Oréal, which for those of us based in France know that's kind of a breeding ground for marketing executives all over the tech scene. And then you spent some time at 360 Learning, which is another highly regarded French tech startup, did some international expansion, I believe, into New York City. So I want to talk a little bit about your background, kind of your entry into marketing and in the tech world, and how that might have shaped some of your approach to company building, startup building
today. Thanks for asking. So I think it's a pretty funny story, because I think it's not very common to actually make the shift from a big organization such as L'Oréal to a company like 360 Learning, because when I joined, I think we were maybe around 25, 30 people. And I think impacted me for two different aspects. I would say the first one is really the way I approach marketing, which is very B2C oriented. And the second part is more about the way I approach future of work, future of organization, etc. And basically what we are doing today at Clap with which is the meeting issue. Switching from L'Oréal, which is super meeting centric company, any type of decision happens in the meetings, etc. And then when I joined 360 Learning, we had a no meeting policy. So everything was based on asynchronous collaboration. We used to use Trello to make any type of decisions and so on. And so I would say for 4 to 5 years, I've really learned what it means to build a culture around asynchronous collaboration. I saw the big meeting centric company with L'Oréal. Then I experienced the no meeting policy with 360 Learning. It's something that was really hard to scale. We didn't manage to maintain the no meeting culture. And also it was also for me good experience to learn what it means to build a culture around asynchronous collaboration, but also all its pitfalls, all its limitations, etc. In terms of use cases you can cover, but also in terms of culture you are building. And I think one big discovery was if you want to implement asynchronous collaboration, if you only rely on async written communication, you are going to build culture that are kind of geeky niche, the one you can find, for example, GitLab, Zapier, Alan in France, and so on, to sum up companies of culture of people that don't really to talk. And I think it's part of the reason why we started Clap is really to say, okay, today with this shift to distributed work, you need to master asynchronous collaboration, but we miss a format in between written communication and meetings, which is more interactive, more engaging, and so on. And that's typically the kind of stuff that we are trying to create with Clap and what we call async video collaboration. And I think it's part of this, pass from L'Oréal to 360 Learning that brought me a lot. And on the second aspect, which is more about the way I approach marketing, I think the cosmetic industry, the beauty industry in general, it's pretty interesting, because in terms of product innovation, it's almost the no code industry, but maybe 10, 20 years ago. Basically, you don't have tons of big product innovation. So it's really hard to build a defensive product purely on a technology. All the beauty products in the end, in terms of mix, formulation and so on, it's really hard to do something very, very different. So the way you build something different is first is in terms of product positioning, and also it's in terms of brand building. And in the end, you really need to deep dive and understand about the key insights and problems of your users, but also about the perception of the product. So for example, one key stuff I learned at L'Oréal was and it's really something I loved doing, was when you do qualitative research, qualitative testing, You know, when you work, so I was working on like on the product development. So basically my job was to create like the kind of product you see in store in 2 years, 3 years, and so on. And you have like the first phase, which is like you basically like you write the concept about your new range, your new product, etc. Like starting with like the kind of problems and key consumer insight that you are trying to solve. And then you write a new concept. But most of the time, and then you try to build the formula to formulate with like your laboratory the formula to answer like this insight and this problem. And one part of the development is to basically test the concept with like women. So what happens is that you do a lot of like qualitative research. So you are like you know like behind the shades, and then you have like someone basically like showing to people like your formula. Your new concept, like your new packaging, and so on, and then you really learn like to detect like the way people react to your new product. And I think one key learning was often what is the most important for like users and consumers is not what you expect at first. So and what triggers emotion is not what you expect at first. It's not like some complex technology. It's more like the fragrance, it's more like the color, it's more like the visual, and so on. And in the end, like I think like people that don't really care about like your technology and your product, but they really remember about like the how you made them feel when they experience your product, when they experience like your brand, your website, etc. And you really need to pay attention to that. And I think like the what happened in the beauty industry is now happening also in the software industry, because like today it's really easy to build a new software, and with like the shift to like the no code era, it's not that complex to build like to build new products. So it's really about understanding like the kind of problems that you want to solve, design the best problem to solve like this specific problem, but also in terms of like experience. Both in the product, in terms of UX, but also in terms of like communication, narrative, storytelling, even like colors or typography and so on, is really about triggering the right emotions for your users. And I think it's really something I learned working at L'Oréal. And it's really something that struck me when I joined the B2B space, was like how far it was compared to the B2C world in terms of like really understanding people. Because I think like most people in the B2B, they think that they speak to companies, but in the end, I think like it's just the same type of people that buy like personal stuff and that also like buy software in organization. It might be a bit more complex, but in the end, it's still about people, and we see like more and more like this shift to like B2C marketing apply to B2B marketing.
Well, it's very clear looking at your website that that is kind of your frame of mind when designing the personas that you're going after and the messaging around the tool. I mean, the website is colorful, it's playful, although it is in a sense a B2B tool. You are addressing more of a B2C audience. So maybe we can talk a little bit about the idea for Clap and then how you were able to apply the learnings from 360 Learning from L'Oréal, your entire kind of marketing mindset to driving user acquisition and building a brand around a tool that, like you said, people don't care that much about the technology on the back end. They care about how it makes them feel, or the value that it brings them, or the time that it saves them. And from just a quick glance at your site, it's very clear that you make that messaging front and center.
Yes, so to explain what we are building with Clap and the kind of playbook and framework that we apply, but what we are building at the moment is that what we call asynchronous video collaboration, which is like to sum up a new alignment and decision-making system for the distributed world. And the key idea is to say that now we have like this huge shift to the distributed like work. Now people are going to work in both like at home, in offices, in co-working spaces, etc. It's going to impact the work for the upcoming maybe like 10 years. But today it comes with one big issue, which is back-to-back meetings have become the norm. Like what used to take 5 minutes in the same office has turned like by default into like a 30 minute video call. And we like the core of the problem is that today, anytime we want to align and make decisions, we are stuck between like two options. So we have option one, asynchronous written communication. Like for example, Trello, which is like the stuff we used to have at 360 Learning, can be like emails, Notion, Slack, and so on. It's flexible, but at some point we lack contact, we lack interactivity. So there's always a moment where like, okay, let's talk about it, let's align, and we end up in a Zoom call. And the idea behind like async
Right.
video collaboration is really to create a new way to align and make decisions that combines the flexibility of async communication with the context and interactivity of a meeting. And basically like so in terms of like product and the way we build the product is to say when you want to create alignment, make decisions, there are like always 4 steps. So let's say for example I'm a product manager. I want to get like feedback on a new prototype I'm working on. I need feedback from like many different stakeholders. It's something like a bit complex. I know I can't do it async because it like people are going to miss context. So instead of doing that, most of the time I'm going to run a series of meetings to present my stuff, to get feedback, to make decisions, and so on. So instead of doing that, what I'm going to do, I'm going to start a recording of my screen, presenting like the prototype. Then people like will receive the video, will be able to annotate the video with feedback. Like and this feedback is tied to both a specific minute, but also a specific like zone of the screen that you can highlight. Then we can have like it's going to open a thread, so we can have like conversations related to this feedback that will be able to turn into next steps and decisions, but without the need to be in the same room at the same time. So it's really about like the blueprint and our framework is really about like you share recording with context, then you collect feedback, then you turn feedback into decisions. And at scale, what we are like trying to build is really with like this idea of like workspace is to build a system of record for like decisions in the organizations. Because you know one stuff realize is that you know when we are all in the same office, it's pretty easy to have context. We can like grasp conversations, we have a sense of what's happening. But when we are not in the same office, we have a void of context, so we are trying to compensate by actually like scheduling meetings. And I think like that's why we speak more and more about how to create more transparency in organization. And I think one mistake we do is that most of the time we approach that with like just a knowledge base angle. So we are going to create like huge knowledge base for months, only to realize maybe that 2 weeks after it's completely like outdated. But if you want to create transparency, actually like you need to give people access to like key decisions and actually like help them reverse engineer those decisions so they are able to basically like move forward and make decisions on their own and so on. And that's typically like what companies like Alan and 360 Learning are doing. For example, Alan, they are like using GitHub to centralize all decisions. And so it's kind of a hack to do it. And the way we are like building CLAP is really to become like this system of decisions on the long run.
I mean, I've worked at a number of startups, and even when we were in the office, it can be challenging to find consensus or schedule time. And then the pivot to remote work in the early stages of the pandemic just threw threw everything into a bit of chaos. So I'm curious, kind of, what you've experienced over the course of the past couple of years, the transition from, fully in-office work to a full remote schedule was a big shift. And like you said, these back-to-back meetings, things that could have taken 5 minutes in the hallway now became 30-minute, hour-long meetings. No one had time to do deep work or focused work because they're always trying, context switching, trying to find each other on Slack or whatever other tool they're using. So what was that transition like? And now that we're moving into a more hybrid era, what is the kind of the second big pivot? How is that changing the way that people operate, and how is CLAP solving
You
for
know, it's
that?
pretty funny because I think like the naming of the way we work, my feeling that it's changing every 3 4 months. So like last year it was remote work, then it was a bit of like distributed work, now it's a bit of like hybrid work and so on. And I think it's more that like the moment where you don't have like all the people in the same office, if you want to create an inclusive culture, whatever you call it, but you need to be, you need to be, I think, async first. Like, for example, it was pretty funny because at 360 Learning we were async first, but when I joined, we were in the same office. Everyone was in the same office. Then actually, I left to New York, and we opened, basically, we opened like an office in London and another one in New York, and we were still in like offices. It was pretty easy to work remote, but like it was still like office first company. But the way we operated was still like async first. And then with the pandemic, we made the switch to actually like remote first, and that was actually like pretty easy to manage because like the operating system was async first. And I think what matters is more not where people work. It's more like the default way to communicate and to make decisions, because I think like the like whatever you call it, distributed work, hybrid work, and so on, I think the key stuff that we realize with the pandemic is that we live in a digital first world. Like for example, if you what happened is that we got rid of the offices for like almost like 2 years, and we realized that the world like didn't collapse, like the work, like the companies, they didn't collapse. But I think like if you had made the opposite, so meaning like you got rid of all the softwares and only keep like the offices, I think most companies would have collapsed. And I think it's more like the big realization is that we live in a digital first world. It's almost like more important than the physical one. And it means that we are now able to live in a more, much more like flexible workspace. Some companies are going to work in offices. Some companies are going to be like fully remote. We are like fully remote, for example. Some companies are going to like a mix of both. But I think like the big learning is that we are able to we are not, we don't need offices to be efficient. And then like, I think like companies will find their balance. And also second key learning, I think even like when launching Clap, is as you said, like some organization, as they grow, they become distributed even in the same office. Because for example, like Conto is like our biggest customer, and most of the time they are like in the same office. But maybe because they are like so big at the moment, even internally it's really hard to catch up because like they don't have like the same schedules. Maybe they are like not at the same floor and so on. So even like at a certain size, you become distributed. Even like for example at L'Oréal, I had to interact with people in Korea, in China, in the US, and so it's like it's distributed companies. It's just like we don't really care anymore if people are in the office or not.
Well, it sounds to me like, ultimately every company is going to have some distributed or remote component. And even if you work in the same office place, if you're at a scale up, new people are joining all the time, catching up on context, back-to-back meetings, it's inevitable. But the one kind of key element of every company that seems to be successful at this new strategy is setting a tone and leading by example. So for example, you mentioned the no meeting policy at Allen and the no meeting policy at 360 Learning. What have you seen in some of the leaders that you work with, customers or otherwise, or previous companies that have set that tone or policy early on to set the team up for success in a remote or hybrid or whatever environment they determine best fit for the
Yes,
company?
I think for me, I think it has to do in the way you collaborate in organizations. And I think there are like, I would say like three components in like efficient collaboration. The first one is that the way you design your organization and your design scopes. And I think like one common stuff that Alan and 360 Learning did well was to say, okay, we want to build like a distributed, but meaning like decentralized organization in terms of ownership. We want to make sure that people can be like quite autonomous on their scope. So it's really about like first, the first thing that you need to do is to design well your organization so people don't need to align all the time because they know their mission, their goal, what they need to do, and they feel responsible to achieve like those goals. I think the second part is really about like road mapping, planification, and so on, to really like manage well like all the interfaces between like the different scope. So for example, if you take like a product launch, it's going to involve like a lot of people in the organization, and you don't want to improvise that. You want to plan ahead to know exactly what you want to do, who is going to do that, like the timing and so on. And then the last part of efficient collaboration is more like on a daily basis, like the way you receive feedback, the way you make like decisions, and you can have like tools like Clap, you can have like Trello and so on. But I think it has to like all the different like aspects, they have to be like super clear in order to build like efficient distributed organizations.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about video. Video is a key component of your kind of collaboration and asynchronous meeting tool. There's a couple of things. Video is obviously trending across the board. Part of that is a technological reason. We have the bandwidth and we have the servers and we have the devices to support endless streaming video. TikTok is a great example there. You know, it's the most popular social media app out there. Everyone's creating videos. Now, in the business context, there are a couple of tools that come to mind. I've used one called Loom for recording videos internally and sharing them with project teams, for example. I believe Gong is another tool that's really designed for sales teams. You can record a demo and share it with a prospect and see if they've opened it or viewed it. It helps with the kind of marketing funnel. And now you guys are leveraging video as kind of the core component of what you're calling the asynchronous meeting blueprint. It's the ability to record the video, annotate the video, and create context around it. So curious how you decided to incorporate video and why that's such a key element of the product. And then maybe you can elaborate on the async meeting blueprint or framework, how you guys think about using video as the cornerstone of context creation and collaboration in the enterprise or at a
Okay,
startup.
yeah, super interesting. So I would say like the way we approach video, I think like the key question for us was like how to solve the back-to-back meeting issue. And in the end, like the one key stuff that we realized is that if we want to get rid of meetings, it's not about like taking a meeting and moving it async. Like because people they don't want to watch like a 30-minute long like video like even async, and but the key question is that what are like the core jobs to be done of meetings that we need to make sure that we do maybe 10 times better an async tool. And I think like one of them was like one key aspect what you have in meeting that you don't have in for example in the tool like Slack or emails. Like async written communication is really about like sharing context. You know, like we work on tons of like different documents, can be like business plans, spreadsheets, slide deck, Figma prototypes, and so on. And you know, like when you want to explain something, it's not enough to just like write. You need to provide like more context, and you want to provide like I would say like high level context. So meaning like the problem that you are trying to solve. The kind of issues you are trying to validate today, the kind of feedback you expect, and so on. And this is something that you do like pretty easily when you are in a meeting, when you like start sharing your screen. So the idea of incorporating video was we like to replicate what we do live in a meeting, but that you can do like async. And that's why we have like one key component of like Clap is we like video recording. This part is not that different from like Loom, for example. And that's why you can really like use Clap the same way that you use Loom for like many use cases. But then like and it's I think it's a good point with like to explain also like the framework. But we also realize that the reason why we have like so many meetings is because like meeting is a default place to first share context, but also like to gather feedback, precise feedback from any stakeholders. It's also the default place to make decisions and so on. And the idea was also was to really like build a product that does that. And that's why like the blueprint, the way we the blueprint is to sum up, it's a way to explain the product compared to the problem we are solving. And it's also a way to present the roadmap and the way we are like building the product in the future. And this blueprint, we have like four pillars. So the first one is, and the key question is that async video collaboration or async meeting, it's a new way to make decisions, to create alignment. And when you want to make decisions, there are always four steps. The first one is that you share context, hence like the video recording. The second part is that you want to collect feedback. And the key question is how to make it like super smooth to collect feedback. Then you want to turn feedback into decisions. And for example, we realize that in the meeting, there are a lot of features that we like that help people like turn feedback into decisions. For example, you can vote on some stuff. You have a notion of due date. You can also control that people in the room have actually like seen what you are like sharing and so on. And all those features are stuff that we are also introducing in the product. And then the last part is really about like sharing like those decisions and minutes. And that's really like the way we are like building the product. And also to answer your question about like so comparison versus Loom, I would say it's like a Loom but designed for feedback and decisions, not purely for like video recording. And compared to Gong, I think it's a different like use case. Gong is more like what they're doing is revenue intelligence. So like the key feature is to record like live meetings that you have, to be able to automatically analyze those calls, create alerts, so it's actually easier for sales managers, sales enablement managers to actually like coach, especially like remotely, their sales team because you can analyze everything. You can, let's say, like track like pricing discussions and so on. And in the end, my feeling that there are more and more like replacing like it's a new form of CRM, like tracking all interaction with like customers. And but on our side, it's more it's a new collaboration tool and it's really a new decision-making system that we are like creating.
That's very cool. I'm curious about kind of the longer term roadmap, and I would imagine you've gotten some good feedback from early customers, but if you want to become the operating system of context, content, and decision making within a startup or an enterprise, naturally you're going to have to integrate with other tools that the company is using, and you know, to help build transparency or to create workflows between you know one team or another. Can you talk about kind of what the next stages are for Clap? Where do you see the product moving? What direction in the next you know year, 2 years?
So I think at the moment, like if we refer in terms of like integrations, but like one key area that we are trying to improve is really like activation rate, like how to make it like super easy to start recording a clap for like where you work. And that's why we are adding like a lot of like integrations, like to start recording from like Figma, from like Spreadsheet, Google Doc, and so on. So that's really like the first part. And at the moment, we are like trying to make it like super easy to start like recording claps from anywhere, because in the end, it's what we are building, it's a new decision making system, it's a new alignment system, but it's super quick. It's not a complex tool. You can like start recording in like in 5 seconds. You can share a link and that's it. It's super easy, and we really want to nail like this part because it's super important for activation. And I would say like on the other side of the spectrum, you have like this blueprint. So we are also like building up on what we have in terms of like workspace. So for example, like today you can centralize all your recordings per what we call topic. But next week we are going to launch like Teams and so on, because the idea is really and in the end, it's pretty close to what you have, for example, in collaboration tools such as ClickUp, Asana and so on, because it's something that is really, really different compared to something like Loom, for example. It's really like it's a platform that we are building. And in terms of integration, also what it means is that, you know, all the decisions that you do in Clap, you'll make in Clap, you'll be able to push them into your project management tools such as Asana, Trello. So meaning that you have your video, you collect your feedback. Then at some point you want to mark a feedback as a decision, but also you want to create a task from clap but directly to a Jira, for example.
Sure. Okay. So I guess that kind of reminds me of something you were talking about earlier is like acquisition strategy. For a tool like this, what is your go-to-market plan typically? Is it product-led growth, community-led growth? Are you going for individual users who then love it so much that they kind of spread it within their organization? It's supposed to be, as you mentioned, like your approach to building something that's super easy to use, integrated within other tools. I think of like a Google Chrome extension that makes it pretty simple to onboard a customer. What have you seen thus far with your current user base, and how is that impacting
Yes,
your
so I think
traction?
in terms of like a go-to-market, the way we enter into organization is really like the I think the land and expand strategy we have is to start with like product teams, product managers, product designers, or even product marketers, so product and marketing, because this is where we solve like the biggest alignment issue. You can and you can start with a mix of like super tactical use cases. Like a QA bug reports, but also like more complex one, like design reviews, for example. And then we see like starting at the product team, but we like growing into the entire organization. So for example, like customer success is also like the tool is pretty popular, like to when you need to explain like complex stuff to your customers, when you want to share like libraries of recordings to your customers and so on. So that's we like the go-to-market we have like land in the product design marketing and then expand to the rest of the organization. And in terms of acquisition channels, so it's a PLG we have like a PLG playbook because like you share a recording and then like people can comment on it. And so that's we like one key part of the acquisition at the moment. But we also want to it's not the only one, like the typical like key channels that we have. So we are not doing paid marketing and we are not going to do paid marketing I think for a long time because it's not you don't want to create a dependency too soon when you do like PLG. But I would say it's like so PLG viral loop it's one of them. The second one is more SEO because like in the end with Clap we serve like a problem for super specific use cases, like for example, how to do a good design review, how to align on your product spec, how to do design testing, and so on. And we want to make sure that we cover all the keywords that potential users are searching for. Third one, I would say that works pretty well from the beginning is really like brand marketing campaigns and social media, such as like the launching on Product Hunt. And we are trying to basically like do two big launches every year. That's really like part of like the when you do like category design, you want to have like a major announcement that you are doing like twice a year, what we call lightning strike. And that's really like one big part of basically increasing word of mouth. And I would say like the last one is more like co-marketing. What we realize is that we have like a huge peak of new sign up and visitors anytime we are like mentioned on the product newsletter, all those kind of stuff. So it's really something that we are going to try to systematize more and more.
Nice.
Now we say it's
Very
pretty
cool.
early. We need
Well,
we
I
need
want.
to iterate. It's all the channel we have in mind at the moment, but we just opened the product like 1 month ago. So we are now at this phase where we need to crack the different acquisition channels, or maybe have maybe like three of them, but we need to test.
Well, I want to close out kind of thinking about the future of work. I mean, I'm sure that's something that you think about almost every day, working on Clap. There was a post recently on Twitter from Elon Musk, of all people, kind of threatening termination to employees. I think it was at Tesla, who weren't coming back to the office. Now, obviously, that's kind of a physical product, right? So there's a line of people working at the factory who are putting together components or designing things. But it, you know, there's a lot of discussion on Twitter around, okay, are executives going to start, you know, forcing people back into the office? Does this make sense for every company? You know, what are we going to snap back in this post-pandemic era? I think you addressed it earlier in that, you know, every company is, it's going to be kind of it won't be a one size fits all. There's going to be a variation across the board, and a lot of it is around setting the tone. But I'm curious kind of what your impression was of that particular instance on Twitter and this kind of lingering uncertainty around, you know, how we are going to work and cooperate and come to decisions collectively in this uncertain
Yeah,
future.
so I would say like the post for me just illustrate that the key question is that are you in the digital first or physical first industry? And it's true that when you do like rockets and cars, it's hard to be like a digital first. And I think like the second question, and I think it's a good point, is more to how to build like an inclusive culture when some people have to go to the office and some others are like remote. And I think can also be the opposite in some hybrid organization that are in the end like office first organization. And a lot of people, they report that when they work remotely, then they can feel like excluded. So I think it's I to be honest, I don't know how it's going to I don't think it's going to be like a one size fits all. I think like what it shows is that people and employees are going to be like much more demanding in terms of culture building. I think like working in the same office, it removes a lot of the questions that you need to address when building a company culture because a lot of stuff are very, very organic. But when it's not like this, you need to be like much more intentional. And so it's going to be much more challenging for organization to define their culture. It's something they need to work on. And I would say like in the end, like remote work is going to stay because it's what people want. And it's also what the most, I would say, like requested talent are requesting. Like if you work in tech, the key talent are like software engineers. And software engineers are the ones that really want to work remotely. And I think like in the end, like companies will adapt to that and will have to figure out a way to make it work. So I don't feel like companies will have the choice unless you define a very, very radical culture where you state we only hire people that work like full time in the office. But it's going to be like but they need to market it like this way. And because I think like the point of company building and culture building is not to have a culture that attract like 100% of people. Is more to say that you want to be loved by maybe 10% of people. And so it's completely fine not to appeal to 90% of people. So I think like there is one path to say we are like a office only a company that can work, but I'm not sure it's going to be the majority of companies.
Well, listen, thank you so much for joining and helping us navigate this this brave new world of distributed work. And also congratulations on your success on Product Hunt and your launch. I know we've been in touch for some time now, so it's exciting to see the evolution of Clap, and I look forward to seeing where you guys are at the end of 2022.
Thanks, Hayden.
Yeah, thanks for joining.